Good morning and welcome to the October Frank Talks, which is a candidates forum for the October 24th Franklin City election for Ward Alderman. I'm Mindy Tate, Executive Director of Franklin Tomorrow. First off, please silence your phones. If you haven't done so already, please silence your phones. We are going to move rather quickly. We first want to thank Vanderbilt University as well as the Williams County Enrichment Center for helping us host this event, and our partners in this event, which are Williamson Inc., the Williams County Association of Realtors, and the Williamson Herald. But I'm going to turn it over very quickly to Franklin City Administrator Eric Stuckey. I was going to call him government, but Eric Stuckey, our city administrator, who's going to explain a little bit about how Franklin government works. We'll start our forum in just a few minutes. Thank you so much, Eric. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you. It is great to see so many folks out here on a sort of overcast Monday morning. Appreciate the engagement here today. That's a big part of what makes Franklin work, and we really appreciate you being out here and being part of it. I've been told I have 10 minutes or less to tell you everything you need to know about how city government functions. So here we go, folks. This is part of something we've been doing for a while with Franklin Tomorrow that we call City Hall on Wheels. And we try to go out every few months to different locations, and we may present some aspect of what the city does, but we also have a Q&A session to talk about. You can't hear me? Wow, that's rare. Okay, and I just actually went about five slides in. Okay, so we're going to talk. You got me? Okay, good. We're going to talk about different elements of it, and I want to thank Franklin Tomorrow, Williamson County Association of Realtors, Williamson Herald, and Williamson Inc. for being part of this and sponsoring this. And I also especially want to thank the candidates. These folks have given of themselves and put themselves out there to serve their community, and we respect that beyond words. That is a great thing to do, and that's what our community and our country is built on, is folks who step up and serve. And I want to thank them for that as well. And I thank you, the citizens, for engaging and participating. So this is Government 101. I did not pass out a syllabus. There will not be a quiz or a test or a term paper, so you're in luck. So you can relax. So let's go ahead and look at it. First of all, Board of Mayor and Aldermen. Good way to think of it, as we all learned in our civics classes, think of the mayor's office, who is elected every 4 years, as sort of our executive branch. The mayor chairs the meetings. The mayor provides direction in those meetings, helps set the agenda, working with me and working with staff team to put that together, and basically reports to the community about the state of our city, does that annually. It gets more and more entertaining each year, right, Mayor Moore? Try to make sure good information gets out to you in a way that helps our citizens and informs our community. So the mayor does that, and guess what? The mayor only votes when there's a tie. So that's a challenge in that aspect, that you don't really vote very often, and when you do, it's probably a pretty controversial item, right? So looking at the aldermen, think of the aldermen as our legislative branch. They are the group that votes on and approves ordinances and ultimately approves the budget. And so they work with, in the committee structure that we have today only has two committees. In prior years, there were multiple committees beyond that, but in the last 9 years, we've gone to a two-committee structure, which is a capital investment committee, which deals with large infrastructure investments, and a budget and finance committee, which is exactly what it sounds like, budget and financial information that they work on. And so those committees work once a month. They meet, and they provide direction there, but they don't decide anything finally. Any action that happens at the committee level ultimately goes to the board for final approval. And so our group of aldermen is split into two groups. We've got four that are elected at large, and those happen with the mayoral election every 4 years, and four that are elected by ward, which is also a four-year term. So they're staggered. So there's always some continuity that half of the board is in place throughout any transition that happens in an electoral process. So obviously we're in the midst of the ward election, which will take place this month and is already taking place as we speak, actually, because early voting is underway. So you look at the wards, there they are. There are four wards. They're roughly balanced in terms of population. Each time after the federal census, we go and we rebalance them so that they are equal, so that there's fairly equal representation of our citizens across there. It's modified a little bit with some certain geographical elements that make sense, but when we did it in 2010, it was almost exactly balanced among those four wards. So that's one of the elements we pay key attention to. And so here's our org chart. You see right at the top, the citizens of Franklin, they appoint their representatives on that board of mayor and aldermen. Then you see the board, and then you see my position, the city administrator. I am the one employee that the board hires. Think of it as an analogy to a corporate board, as a board of directors hires a CEO to run the day-to-day operations. Or on the public side, a school board hires a school superintendent to run those operations. So that's my job. And folks that report to me, ultimately the entire employee team works with me in one way or another, but my direct reports include police and fire, our legal and HR side, our recorder and communications elements, and then the three assistant city administrators also report to me, each of which have teams that work with finance and administration in one group, our public works group, and then finally our community and economic development group. So that's how we're set up. Again, it's sort of a corporate structure designed to have efficiency in our day-to-day operations, but also accountability and responsibility to our elected board and ultimately to our community. All right, so as city administrator, it's a full-time position. I'm appointed by the board. I am the one employee they hire. And then the other 711 of our team works through me. I look at my job as sort of a bridge between the board and the guidance and vision they have for the community, and also the great ideas and thoughts that our professional staff has about the best way to serve the community and make things work. So each needs each other. A great idea on the staff side needs a budget or an ordinance in place, but a vision on the board needs a team that's going to be able to implement it and deliver it. So that's how we work. I am an at-will employee, which means the board can let me go anytime they want to. The majority of them think that. And so I say every Wednesday morning after a board meeting that I come in, had a pretty good board meeting. So anyway, my job is really to discuss the business with specific aldermen around constituent services. That's a day-to-day aspect. Oversee the day-to-day operations of everything we do. Present a budget to the board on an annual basis, and then follow up on any elements that are there. And then my job is also direct accountability, appointment, et cetera, of our entire city team, especially our department directors. And those department directors take direction from me. They are also considered at-will employees, and they have any myriad of responsibilities. It's hard to put it all up there, but each of them have sections of the municipal code that they're responsible for enforcing or that describe the nature of the services they deliver. And so that's part of what they work from, is what's on the books and just being responsive to the needs of our community and to citizens. All right, our vision. This is a vision statement we crafted several years ago, but I just will cover it for you. Franklin will continually strive to be a community of choice for individuals, families, and businesses to grow and prosper through an excellent quality of life supported by exceptional, responsive, and cost-effective city services. Okay, a lot of words. Couple key phrases. Community of choice. We believe we compete every day for the investments of families, of businesses, of visitors. And so we take that very seriously. There's a stereotype that government doesn't compete like a normal business. I don't think that's so true anymore. I think people have choices every day about where they are and more opportunities or options to be different places. And we want to be a place people choose to live in, because the next key point, quality of life, is so great here. It's a place that people want to be, and we want to make it that way. And quality of life has hundreds of different definitions. What the city does is creates an environment for that to happen. Some cases it's direct, a beautiful park, different elements that we take care and beautify, but also it's the environment. We create an environment where people want to invest or create quality of life on their own that is for them or for others. And we want to do that. And the way we do that is through great services, exceptional services, being responsive to the needs of our citizens. And obviously, we've got to be responsible with the dollars we're given as well. So that's what the effective city service component is about, that we do it right and we use those dollars well. The board has developed a strategic plan, the first that the city's ever had in place. It has four key components to it, but about 65 other measures and benchmarks that help us track our progress in these four key areas. And it talks about safe, clean, livable city, having an effective, fiscally sound city government that provides high-quality services, quality life experiences, and then finally, sustainable growth and economic prosperity. So there's lots of different components under that. I'll encourage you to look on our website. We've got all those measures out, and you can look at how they're measured. You can even manipulate them yourself to look at how they measure and compare over time as well. And we'll talk about that in just a second. This is a key component in terms of how we do what we do, that we manage well and provide a high level of service in the management side, that we focus on high quality community development, which is high standards and high quality investment, that we're highly competitive. And then finally, a key measure and support is our strong financial base, that we do long-term financial planning. We look at the impacts of key investments in the community. We have a AAA bond rating from both Standard & Poor's and Moody's. That puts us in about the top 100 of cities across the country that have that double AAA rating from two different rating agencies. And so that's a key component. This is something we share with the rating agencies when we talk about our overall strategy. So lots of plans for the future. I won't go into all of them, obviously, but these are just things to know that we've focused on and put in place. The strategic plan I talked about before, the comprehensive transportation plan, the land use plan and Vision Franklin, which was largely developed by our staff team working in concert with the community. The Parks Master Plan, the Integrated Water Resource Plan, which is a 30-year outlook on all aspects of how we use water and interface with the Harpeth River. The financial policies and benchmarks that we have in place that track us to keep that AAA bond rating. And then finally, our focus on capital investments. We have a 10-year outlook there in public safety, fully accredited police operation with flagship status and an ISO rating of 1 for our fire service, which puts us in the top 0.5% of fire departments in the country. Okay, economic drivers in this community are incredible. Five consecutive quarters where we led the country, our county led the country in job growth. And the majority of that job growth happened right here in Franklin. That the presence of corporate headquarters, all of these elements are a key component to our success. And one of the things that makes Franklin and Williamson County a driver in the state of Tennessee's economy as well. All right, just give you a quick budget overview. These are the key elements. We have lots of budget goals, but they really fall into one of these five categories: maintaining high quality services, investing in the future, taking advantage of the opportunities that are before us while we maintain the quality and the character of the community. That's the challenge. So when you look at our budget, you look at where the dollars come from. Over half of them come from sales tax. So the drivers of the Cool Springs Galleria Mall, the vibrancy that you see in downtown, really add up to over half of our revenue in the general fund, which is about $69 million of total revenue in the general fund. When you look at the rest of it, state shared tax is around 18%. That's money we get back from the state that is largely from the sales tax that comes into the state back to communities by our population. And then our property tax, here it says about 10%. That's what's left over after we pay debt service. So in reality, property tax is probably closer to 20%. But Franklin is kind of the inverse of most cities in Tennessee in that we have half of it from sales tax and 20%-ish from property tax. Most communities are the opposite. Over half of it comes from property tax and sales tax is maybe around a quarter. So the vibrancy and activity that we see in our sales tax and is a key component to our budget. And when you look at our overall revenue structure, almost three quarters of our revenue though comes from consumption of some kind, whether it's sales tax or the portion that comes back from the state that is sales tax based, or things like beer and alcohol taxes, those kind of things. That is a key driver to what we do. And consumption taxes are a little more sensitive to changes in the economy. So that's part of why we maintain a higher reserve than most communities do too, because the economy can hit us quicker than a property tax, more property tax dependent government. All right, where do we spend it? About half of it goes to public safety. And so that's police and fire. You see other elements, public works around 17%, community and economic development 13%. So that's where the dollars go in terms of functional in the general fund. When you look at the expenditures by the types of categories, it's almost 70% on personnel costs. So we deliver our services through people. Police and fire, that number is closer to 80% because it's driven by having people present in the community, picking up that trash, repairing that street, fixing that water line, being ready at a fire station or on the patrol in our police department. So it is very much driven by people and the costs associated with having a great staff team and developing those folks. That's it. And I know I don't have time for questions, Mindy. I'm sorry. I hope I stayed okay in my time frame. Thank you for having me. And again, thank you for being part of the process.
Thank you so much, Eric. Thank you for being here. We're going to start our candidates forum. Tom Lawrence of WAKM, AM 950, will be our moderator. And the questions will be framed by representatives of Franklin Tomorrow, Williamson Inc., Williamson Herald, and the Williams County Association of Realtors. The program will begin with each candidate being given a one-minute opening statement for use as they see fit, and I would ask the candidates to please come forward and begin to sit in your chairs. Responses to each question will be 1 minute in length as well. All questions will be asked of each candidate, although the order of those answering questions first will rotate throughout the wards and in alphabetical order until the second round, when the alphabetical order will shift to the second candidate in the race with the first candidate answering second and so on as time allows. There will be no questions from the audience, although we did review those questions submitted by you. To date, early voting opened on last week, and at the end of the day on Friday, less than 100 people had voted in these races. Less than 1% of the city's registered voters had voted in these races. So please tell your friends. This is being broadcast right now on Facebook Live. It can be shared from there. It will also be on the city's Franklin TV channel, and you can we'll try to put that on our website as to when that's going to be broadcast. I'm going to introduce our panel of those people asking questions. Marilee Bennett, wave your hand. She is the timekeeper candidates right there. We ask you to please be respectful and try to keep your answers as succinct as possible. Our representatives from our panels will be Lisa Worth of the Williams County Association of Realtors, Matt Largen of Williamson, Inc., Carrie Bartlett of the Williamson Herald, and myself. So thank you. I'm going to turn it over to Lisa to ask the first. Oh, we're going to do opening statements. Sorry. And I'm going to turn it over to Tom. He has the order there. So, Tom.
Ward 1, Beverly Berger.
I'll share the mic. Ready? Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to be here this morning. Married to Dr. Ken Berger, we have three sons, two daughter-in-laws, and four grandchildren. I've lived in Franklin for 15 years, and I've been a frequent visitor before in the 80s and 90s. I'm a small business owner with 20 years of experience as a marketing professional. Prior to forming my own business, I wrote and developed advertising campaigns, was the director of franchise sales in a publishing business, and the corporate sales for a Fortune 500 company. My background and skill sets have taught me to be a problem solver. I'm good at bringing different parties together, finding common ground, and identifying solutions that make sense and actually solve problems. And I have done this throughout my tenure. My main focus as your alderman is to continue to preserve our way of life, to protect our community values, and find ways to prosper our community and coordinate it in a carefully planned fashion. And that is my goal. Thank you.
J. Edward Campbell.
Good morning. J. Edward Campbell, a resident of Franklin since 1976, a resident of Ward 1 since 2004. Married to my wife, Brenda, who is here this morning. We have two cats that are rescue cats, Lily and Rusty. Put them up against anybody's kids. I intentionally became involved in this community when I moved here in 1976, continued to be involved as a volunteer in many different aspects. I went through Leadership Franklin, and I now am looking forward to serving the city of Franklin as an alderman. As I have knocked on doors, lots of doors, I've heard people say, you're a good communicator, you listen. You listen to learn, you don't listen to speak. And I think that's a very important quality, to listen, to learn. We can learn every day. I love Franklin. I think those of you who are my Facebook friends know that. If you see the things that I put about Franklin every day, I can't imagine about living anywhere else. I am a realtor. I am out of time.
Michael Phillips.
Good morning. I'm running because I truly believe that serving others is what I've been called to do. I served our nation in the military for 20 years. I was a pilot of Huey and Black Hawk helicopters in the Army. Most of those 20 years were spent overseas. And now I want to serve our community, or continue to serve our community, because I've been doing it for the past couple of years. Via Keep Franklin Franklin, which I created, I've been reaching out into the community to get our citizens more involved, informing them of the issues, asking them for their input and opinion on issues, and then taking their input and opinions to City Hall, standing up in front of the Planning Commission, standing up in front of the Board, Mayor, and Aldermen, and I've been voicing your opinions. I will continue to be the voice of the citizens inside City Hall. Thank you.
From the Second Ward, Dana McClendon.
Good morning. My name is Dana McClendon. My wife and I moved here in 1995 when we were 27 years old and childless. Since then, we've raised our kids here. Our sons are now at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. They were born and raised in Ward 2. In 1997, I decided to run for office, and I walked around and handed people this card, which contained my promises. My promise was that I was committed to maintaining the quality of life in Franklin, and the principles that I decided would help do that would be to preserve the historical character of Franklin, ensure responsible development, support our police and fire departments, keep city services at a high level, maintain Franklin's excellent fiscal reputation. I think the fact that people continue to move here and continue to pick Franklin is proof that I've been doing my part of this. I've made these promises. There's no reason for me to change the principles and the promises that I've made to the people of Ward 2. I'm asking for your support, and I'm asking to be reelected. Thank you very much.
Mike Vaughn.
Hello, my name is Mike Vaughn, and I'm a candidate for Alderman Ward 2. Through my role as an owner of an international business management company and as a former homeowners association president, I've served and advocated for best practices in business and government for 37 years. Until June of 2012, for almost 20 years, I was more likely to be in China than Franklin, and during that time, I was busy establishing educational exchange programs for universities with the U.S. Embassy in Beijing and Shanghai, or helping companies set up their export distribution operations. I've represented a wide variety of industries over my career, including everything from unmanned aerial vehicle guidance systems to Goo Goo clusters. I'm semi-retired now, but I'm still the CEO of an animal health biotech company that makes drugs for horses and dogs. If I'm elected to serve the residents of Ward 2, I'll continue working and advocating for best practices. In the next 5 to 10 years, Franklin will change drastically and irreversibly for the worst if we don't act to preserve the small town we all love and cherish. In 2003, our family moved here because Franklin was a safe, clean, green, and historic small town. Because of the unbridled runaway growth we've experienced over the past 20 years, we risk losing our small town and becoming just another stop on the interstate outside of Nashville. But working together, we can all share in the knowledge and satisfaction that we've provided for the preservation of our small town and for current and future generations. I ask for your support and your vote because it's time for a change.
Ward 3, Michael Skinner.
My name is Michael Skinner. I've been third ward alderman for the last 10 years. My family moved here in 2004. We've lived here in the third ward for this entire time. Eric Stuckey gave a tremendous presentation this morning about the attributes of the city and the planning and the things that go on. I've been involved with that planning, those decisions that have made Franklin what it is over these last 10 years. I've demonstrated leadership ability, and I have a history of working with neighborhoods. I want to continue to do that, and if you'll reelect me as your third ward alderman, I will continue to serve. Thank you.
Scott Speedy.
Good morning, I'm Scott Speedy. I moved to Franklin 36 years ago. Kathy and I have built our careers here. We've got 3 kids in the public school systems, a son at Centennial, and 2 daughters who are enjoying their first day of fall break at the forum this morning at Freedom Middle and Freedom Intermediate. We've always been involved in the community, and this is my next step of progression, I guess, of serving Franklin. I'm a small business owner. As a certified financial planner, director of business and estate planning at Northwestern Mutual, I meet with individuals, families, and business owners every day in our community. I feel like that's the type of professional and business experience that the city of Franklin needs with their strategic direction. As an alderman, I'll commit to 3 things. 1, making sure we got an environment where our existing businesses will thrive and new businesses want to relocate here. 2, I'll continue to support our local historic preservation efforts. And then 3, with my planning background, I'll make sure the city continues to plan properly and is fiscally responsible so we've got the tax dollars to fund our infrastructure needs, our schools, and our quality of life initiatives.
Fourth Ward, Margaret Martin.
I'm Margaret Martin. I'm running for re-election in the Fourth Ward. It's amazing how a large portion of our population thinks we've always been a beautiful, progressive community. That's what we are now, but not without struggles, huge efforts, vision, and finances to fund the services that our citizens expect. Hard lessons have been learned through much sweat and tears, and I'm grateful to have had a role in this throughout the years. As a lifelong resident of Franklin, I would like to continue my efforts to bring about those quality of life issues that mean so much to our residents. Of course, decisions will be made that do not please everyone, but I can assure you that my actions will be to embrace progress while maintaining the character of Franklin.
Elizabeth Downing Wanzek.
Good morning. My name is Elizabeth Downing Wanzek, and Franklin has been my home for over 8 years. My husband and I moved here in 2009, right before he deployed for his second tour to Iraq, and we are truly blessed to raise our almost 2-year-old daughter here. I'm a published songwriter, and until April of this year, co-owned Right Off the Row, a songwriting studio in Nashville. I'm also a paralegal and have had experience doing municipal government paralegal work. I have always been interested in politics, and I have a bachelor's degree in political science from Sewanee, the University of the South. I'm running for alderman because I want to make sure that the city is using its leverage in growing a sustainable city. Franklin has become a coveted destination to both live and work, and I want to make sure that the Franklin we know and love is here to remain while helping to build the Franklin of the future.
The first question will be posed by the Williamson County Association of Realtors.
Thank you, Tom. Hi, my name is Lisa Wirth, and I am with the Williamson County Association of Realtors. Our first question for you all this morning is, what do you think local government should do, if anything, to promote more affordable housing opportunities in the area?
Ward 2.
Me first?
No, Mr. Vaughn first.
Okay. Thank you. I like to refer to it as accessible housing. You know, the government does some things well, but there are some things that the government can do without doing anything. I think you have to foster an environment where the private sector can come together with those places where you can put together a structure for housing to be built. But I'm not so sure it's a place for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen to try to operate and run a business, which can be run by the commercial real estate industry, for example. There are methods to do that, but it's a complex issue, and I think we do need to provide accessible housing for people. It's important, especially for the people of Ward 2 and Natchez and those areas. Those issues are very emotional, and property rights matter, but I'm not so sure the city needs to get involved other than to facilitate a leadership role in trying to bring the parties together.
Dana McClendon.
Well, the city of Franklin can and should make policies that permit the private sector to develop projects that would be affordable. And to do that, we need to have people that buy in, and not just the people that need the homes, but the people that would live in and around the homes. So we need people to understand that it's good for them if people that are nurses and firefighters and police officers and teachers can live in their neighborhood. And it's good for them if for no other reason, there are many, but one great reason is because it helps cut traffic. If people can live near where they work, then they are not out on the road putting in as many road miles in with you and me and everyone else. So what the city can and should do is create a regulatory environment in which the private sector can come to the city with a reasonable expectation that a good project would be given a fair review and perhaps even approved. If we do that enough, we will begin to get enough affordable housing for the needs that we have.
Ward 3, Mr. Speedy.
And I agree, a lot of it comes along with the education of why do we want affordable housing. As Mr. McClendon said, we want to have a place where our police, our fire, our school teachers can work here. We have a large number of hospitality workers in Cool Springs who are driving in from neighboring cities, neighboring counties. That's contributing to our traffic congestion. If we can locate some of that housing closer to our jobs, we're going to eliminate some traffic on our roads. I agree we need to work with our builders and developers so they have an incentive to provide this type of housing to our citizens. We want to find the land that currently our infrastructure can support along the I-64 corridor, land where the citizens can potentially walk to work where I have access to the Franklin Transit, be able to walk to school, be able to walk to amenities like grocery stores. So I think it is something we want to have to make sure we've got a diverse economy and diverse population.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Skinner.
Because of the cost of land in Williamson County, it is very difficult to build affordable housing, especially single-family housing. We need to find the incentives for builders in our area to develop a broad range of price points within their developments. That way, the development will have it built into it when it's proposed to the board. We are limited somewhat on what we can offer, but I think the people that actually build the houses are the ones that have the solution in building more affordable houses.
The fourth ward, Ms. Wanzek.
I firmly believe that if you work in Franklin, you should have the option to live in Franklin. We do, as Mr. Speedy said, have an entire group of people working here that currently cannot afford to live here. Our firefighters, our police officers, our teachers, our nurses, and a whole bunch of people that serve us in the hospitality and food and retail industry. We've got a big problem with traffic right now, and it would go a long way if we could have more people that want to be in this community spending all of their time here, not just coming in from 8 to 5 and then leaving. I have been told that the city of Franklin almost doubles in population size from 8 to 5, and it would be wonderful if we weren't losing everybody else to the other areas, but I think we need to pursue private-public partnerships. I think we need to work with developers to give incentives, and I think we need to all sit down and put our heads together. There's a lot of really smart people here, and I know that we can come up with a way to tackle this issue for Franklin.
Margaret Martin.
Different price range homes are a problem everywhere. It's not just Franklin. We have been supportive of building nice, beautiful homes off Columbia Avenue in property owned by the Franklin Housing Authority. We have rezoned and approved an apartment building on West Main Street that is supposed to be affordable for whatever that word means. Different price ranges is what I would prefer. I don't think it's the city's responsibility to build a home for everybody. I do think that we need to be supportive of the organizations and the agencies that have undertaken this issue, though. And I would certainly be supportive of them and doing whatever the city could do to make it more reasonable for them to build these affordable homes.
Ward 1, J. Edward Campbell.
As a realtor broker in Williamson County, I know firsthand the importance of affordable, attainable workforce housing. Served as the Housing Commission Chairman for the City of Franklin last year and serve on that committee this year. We are presently looking at a 501c3 that would be similar to Friends of Franklin Parks, which would be Friends of Franklin Housing, that would enable builders to come and draw from that fund, that surplus of money, to have the impact fees, the things that need to be done. It is very much an issue, and I think very much the Board of Mayor and Aldermen and the city need to look at it. As I've talked to corporations who say, if we can't have housing for our administrative staff to live here, we may have to leave, we may have to go somewhere else, or we may end up other companies not coming here. So it's an issue that's not gonna go away. It's for a lot of reasons, including people being able to retire here when their children and grandchildren live here.
Mr. Phillips.
I think we all wish that everybody that lives here or works here can afford to live here. I think we've been looking at the issue from one side and keep hitting the same wall, that many people can't afford the housing here. Well, the other side of that is, well, how much money are they making? Minimum wage is $7.50 an hour. The city of Franklin, we market ourselves compared to others at 90th percentile, maybe higher than that. Our police department, with their capabilities and how they function, about the 90th percentile. Fire department at the 99th percentile. Yet City Hall chooses to pay our firefighters and police officers at the 70th percentile, $39,000 a year. That's what city local government can do to solve this problem. Pay our firefighters and police officers what they've earned. And at the county government, pay our school teachers what they earn. Thank you.
Bev Berger.
Thank you. I'm all about incentives versus penalties. That's one of the reasons I was not for inclusionary zoning. I think it's a penalty, it's a tax on people. I don't think government should be an arbiter of housing types and housing prices. And I think we've been long overdue in addressing this problem. We have not done it properly. J. Edward mentioned the 501(c), and the other thing, I just met the other day with Ron Crutcher, we talked about solutions. I said, Ron, we are way overdue with really delving in and getting to the real problem here. So the problem is, this is a great giving community. We give our money to all sorts of charities all the time. Why haven't we had this before? Why hasn't this been done before? It's time to step up to the plate, and the city can be helpful to be a partner in this, but city government does not set and be the arbiter of housing. But the other thing is, we have issues with traffic. You bring people here, don't be deceived that our traffic will not stop. We will get them off I-65, but we're still gonna have to deal with it internally. That was another issue, thank you.
The second question posed by Williamson Inc.
Thanks, Tom. My name is Matt Largen. I'm the president and CEO of Williamson Inc. And I want to echo what Eric said. Thank you all for running and giving your service. I know what a challenge this could be, especially in today's political climate. So I appreciate you all being willing to put yourself out there as leaders in our community. We saw in Eric's presentation earlier that Franklin leads our state's economy with the top job growth in the country last year, which leads to economic opportunities for our friends and families. How does Franklin continue our role as leaders in regional transportation discussions? So how do you move those from discussions to real action and solutions rather than more conversations and more studies? Thanks.
The third ward, Mr. Skinner.
I think we've made a big step this during this last year with the Governor Haslam's improved plan. We now have an option that local governments and counties in Middle Tennessee can now ask for a sustained dedicated revenue that will go to public transportation along the I-65 corridor. The thing that's held us back in the past is there wasn't a sustainable source of money. If this referendum passes, we can begin the work to make the planning and to the design to put mass transit along I-65.
Mr. Speedy.
Well, I think first we need to realize probably the significance of the regional roadway, of what MacArthur could bring to all the neighboring cities and counties around Franklin. I think that's got to be continued to be pushed to the forefront, especially with the passing of the Improve Act to get that on the 3-year plan. We do need to collaborate with all the neighboring cities and counties. Columbia Avenue is a major regional thoroughfare, and obviously that's a very big project right now, and we need to make sure that the $21 million that we're gonna spend on Columbia Avenue, one, we know we need to improve the traffic flow, but two, it's gotta be done in a way that helps our existing business owners out there. They've been the economic engine of this community for multiple generations. And we joke, we can reduce the traffic easily if we just knock all those businesses out and we don't have to worry about any left-hand turn conflicts.
Fourth ward, Margaret Martin.
Traffic seems to be the number one issue. I've lived in traffic all my life, and so I just deal with it. But when I look at Interstate 65 coming and going, it's bumper to bumper. And I have felt for a long time that light rail would be a wonderful thing for us to have. I can just see these parking lots filled with cars and everybody on those little trains going right into Nashville, getting off and being dispersed to their places of employment all of that is part of a big program that must be planned. It must be planned for ways to get around Nashville when you finally get there. So I don't think we can fix this problem in 1 second, 1 minute, 15 minutes even. So we'll continue to work on that.
Elizabeth Wanzek.
Regional transportation is definitely an issue, and I would like to see the city take more of leadership of really pushing to begin those conversations as we become a real metropolitan area. The Music City STAR proposal was originally called a STAR because it was supposed to have 5 points. It's only got the one coming in from Wilson County. I'd love to see one going right up the very active train line straight into Union Station into downtown Nashville. It could pick up in downtown Franklin. We need to really put as much leverage as we can and lobby as much as we can on getting Mac Hatcher finished. And I'm not just talking about the extension that has been approved. I'm talking about really trying to get it the complete circle completed. We are, living in an area that a ton of people are moving to. We live in the South. A lot more people have cars. The more people that can carpool to town, the more things that we can do to emphasize the Franklin Transit System, the more walkability that we can have to encourage people to live closer to where they work is all going to help this.
First Ward, Mr. Phillips.
This one might be easier. Okay.
Earlier this year, I attended the Transit Citizens Leadership Academy in Nashville. I'm glad that the Governor's Improve Act was approved, and it's be a tremendous asset for all of us. There is a plan, the In Motion Plan, that basically connects Clarksville to Columbia and everywhere in between via various kinds of mass transit, buses, trains, and light rail. That's a $6 billion project, and will take probably 20 years. But what we can do is continue to support that. I know City's Monthly is represented at the Metropolitan Transit Authority, and it is part of that solution, and we need to continue to do that. It's not an overnight fix, but there is a plan in place. It's gonna take a lot of money, which is gonna take community support, and I hope you'll support it when you have the opportunity.
Mrs. Berger.
I've attended all the transportation summits, every one of them, all the transportation meetings here, Williamson County, Nashville, regional. And I've listened to these things. We're a day late and a dollar short. But who would have thunk it, as they said, that we would be where we are today? It's Williamson County and Franklin and Nashville, the growth that we've experienced. So we have to play catch up and we have to do these things right. So we have to take it, number one, to the people. What are the people's solutions? What are they willing to afford? And then we need buy-in. We need a federal funding, we need state funding, we need local funding, we need grants, we need corporate buy-in as well. We've got to have this to make it work. So let's talk solutions. I'm working on a circulator for Cool Springs area so people can get out during the day between 8 and 5. They can jump in their cars right now, but they can't go anywhere, it's tough. So a circulator every 10 minutes, you can jump on, get off, go do your business and come back, and we need to be working on the circulator. It's one of the issues, and for a minute, I can't even go into it all. So if you want to know more about it, we'll talk later.
Mr. Campbell.
Traffic is of importance to everybody. As I've been out knocking on doors and talked to a lot of people, I've met people that have moved here from other parts of the country. They think traffic is nothing, so it depends on who you're talking to. We have got to, moving forward, look at some creative plans. And one person asked me, point blank, they brought up Independence High School. They said they changed their times and their start and stop time, and that created some traffic issues there. Would you be willing to go to BGA, the lower campus, as it feeds into downtown, and ask that headmaster to do the same? And I said, absolutely yes.
Second Ward, Mr. Vaughn.
How do you like construction and traffic? You like driving on roads that are under repair all the time? I think we've got to ask ourselves, what do we want our small town to become? Do we want to lose our small town? or do we want to become just another stop along the interstate away from Nashville? I think we've got to protect the core. The core is the small town values, and that's why we moved here. So how do you do that? Well, right now I think we've got to deal with the way that the plans have come together over the past 10 years specifically, and understand what these traffic and construction projects are going to do to our quality of life. Now, transportation is important. We all want to go somewhere, but there are some smart ways to look at doing things, possibly mixing in some tires, buses, using those kinds of mass transit systems. But we really need to think about and never lose sight of the fact that our small town is going away, and it doesn't matter what somebody in Michigan or somewhere else wants us to become. We need to focus on what we are as a small town.
Mr. McClendon.
Well, everybody wants road projects until they get one, and then you have to deal with it. This is an issue where the mayor and the city administrator don't get enough credit. They serve on multiple different boards that address these issues at the state and regional level, and it's largely because of their efforts that we're getting things like Mac Hatcher. Now, that said, I'll take a little credit for Mac Hatcher. I've been working on getting the Mac Hatcher extension done for over 15 years, and when I say working on it, I mean voting to fund the city's plans where we acquired the right-of-way and created the blueprints to build the project. We literally went to the state of Tennessee with a shovel-ready project and said, please do this. And the mayor and the city administrator went to the regional and state federal funding agencies and said, we're ready to go. Here's a project you can do, and we're getting it done. I've also voted to support the creation and ongoing funding of the Franklin Transit Authority, and Ms. Berger's right, the Cool Springs Circulator will be a good part of that. So I'm going to keep doing what I've supported, which is all those things I just said.
Question three is opposed by the Williamson Herald.
Good morning, I'm Carrie Bartlett, the managing editor of the Williamson Herald. And we also have a question about housing. As we all know, for some, it's difficult to live in Franklin. Southern Exposure Magazine and the Williamson Herald recently had a town hall on gentrification, which is the tearing down of older homes and rebuilding newer homes for two or three times the price. Do you think gentrification is an issue in Franklin? And if so, how would you approach that?
Fourth Ward, Elizabeth Wanzek.
It is amazing to see how much change has happened in the last few years. And while neighborhoods do rotate, I think particularly anything that is near the downtown core, we need to be very careful. I am a proponent of the proposed overlay, historic zoning overlay for Natchez, to protect that right near the core. I think certain variances that we have in our zoning codes, we need to make sure we are stringently adhering to them near our core. I moved here because I loved Franklin and what particularly downtown Franklin, which is the heart of the Fourth Ward, means. And I want to make sure that we don't, you know, one day wake up and go, where did it go? This is an issue that's very delicate, and it also involves layers of workforce and affordable housing. And I commend particularly Alderman Bransford's efforts to start these conversations, and appreciate that the Herald and Southern Exposure are also having them with the community.
Margaret Martin.
Also, I think we have to be very cognizant of the people who would like to be able to use their homes for financial gain down the road. Living in a historic overlay district, I'm most pleased with what we have discovered what have been the advantages of that. We feel very protected in a historic overlay. There are people who don't want it, but actually it adds property value to your homes. And the homes that could be destroyed and rebuilt in the two or three story buildings would find that they might be able to take care of what they've got and have those homes still be a part of the fabric of downtown in the Fourth Ward.
First Ward, Mrs. Berger.
Gentrification is a problem, but I don't think government has the answer. I don't think it's government's position to talk about this in a way that where we have authority. Now, can we partner and be of a help to the organizations that are coming alongside of people to try to help address this? Absolutely, we need to be in the conversation. But government needs to be very careful of interfering with the free market. There's no easy answer to this, but I do believe that people have a right to their property rights and their financial gains on their own property. This is a very touchy subject, but it can be dealt with at a community level with different groups, different organizations, working with property owners, working with developers and builders that want to come in and help build some new areas. But it is a very tedious subject, and it is there are no easy answers to this.
Mr. Campbell.
I would totally agree that it's a very serious problem. Again, I see it daily as a realtor, as a broker. I would agree with Alderman Berger that, you know, it's hard. It's very, very difficult to say to somebody, you can't sell your property for X number of dollars. You can't do this. So I think it would take, as she said, working with committees, working with groups and all that will come alongside and do that, because I mean, if somebody knocks on anybody's door in this room, I think, and offers you a price for your house, you're going to take it whether you live in this neighborhood or that neighborhood or wherever. So it's just not an easy solution.
Mr. Phillips.
Yes, gentrification is absolutely a problem in Franklin. What do we think we do about it? I agree with Ms. Berger that this is not a city's, it's not something the city government should get involved with. There is a free market, and people should have the right to profit on their homes if the market allows it. I love that where the overlays are in place, because it does protect those neighborhoods. Now, Natchez Street and Hard Bargain areas are important part of our city and our city's history, and we'd love to see those maintained and grow and thrive. And with the help of the Hard Bargain Association and others, and those organizations can make the effort to preserve those areas. Direct involvement by the city, I don't think that's our place.
Second Ward, Dana McClendon.
Well, it is certainly an issue, especially in parts of Ward 2. This is one where I'm not inclined to say, in effect, I'm here from the government, I'm here to help. I went to the meeting in Natchez, and there's a clear tension between the people who live in the neighborhoods and have invested their generations of their families' lives in those neighborhoods, who do not want to be deprived of the opportunity to reap the benefit of having been homeowners for so long. And on the other hand, we have the concern for the loss of the character of our community. Now, if those neighborhoods form a consensus around an overlay or a protective district, I certainly would be willing to work with them to give them the result that they want. I don't know that I'm gonna be willing to go there and impose any result upon people who are unwilling. So it is an issue, and it's one that pits a lot of these issues against one another, and that's where we have to have the entire community's input to get the right result.
Mr. Vaughn.
Yeah, I support the Hard Bargain Association. I've been over there walking along the streets, and I support property rights. You know, it's self-determination of people where they live that matters. So if the people in Hard Bargain and in Ward 2 get together and they want to form an association or coalition and develop their own regulations for how they're going to deal with their own property, I'm all for that. But I'm not for the city coming in and trying to mandate to a group of people in a neighborhood how they're supposed to form themselves. We can guide them, we can help them. But past that, I think the people on the ground right now have got a pretty good handle on the situation, and I think they're wise people. And just we'll leave it up to the faith leaders and the people that live in those communities to determine that.
Third Ward, Scott Speedy.
I do agree. I believe in the rights of those property owners. I hate to restrict their ability to benefit from the price appreciation and be able to sell those homes for potential financial windfall. I do think in the redevelopment or the teardowns that the new development there has got to be in the character of the existing neighborhood. I think the tough thing about the gentrification is sometimes you hear the stories about seniors living on fixed income, their property taxes go up, they can't afford to live there anymore. Part of that is we can help educate them. There are three different property tax relief options available for some of the seniors. I think that's something we could work with the nonprofits in town as well to help them, but it is a tough issue.
Michael Skinner.
I attended the community meeting about gentrification that was held in Natchez, and it was clear from some of the responses from people who actually live there on property there, there is not a consensus on the way forward. Years ago, there was a historic overlay that was discussed and finally passed in Hinchyville, and that was a very divisive ordinance, and I think there are still people that have hard feelings over that. And this, I'm afraid, would be the same thing in the Natchez area. There are people that have owned property for generations that want to be able to get the full value of what their land is, and there are other people that would like to preserve it. One thing that the land trust does here in Tennessee is to help people that own property put stipulations on what that property can do. I've learned from the preservation meeting last week that you can put a deed restriction on your property to dictate what you want your heirs to do with it. So that may be a solution.
The fourth question from Franklin Tomorrow.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you for being here to the candidates. Williamson County Mayor Rogers Anderson has proposed a referendum which would raise the local option sales tax to the state maximum to provide tens of millions of dollars for school construction and renovation for the next 3 years if approved by the voters. After 3 years, it is estimated the tax will generate as much as $10 million in the cities in which it is collected. Do you support the sales tax referendum, and how would you suggest Franklin use this windfall in 3 years?
First Ward, J. Edward Campbell.
I would support the tax increase. I think that one of the things that is the biggest asset in Williamson County is our school system. I do not have any kids, never had any kids, but I've had tons of clients and friends that have utilized the school system. So yes, I would endorse the sales tax increase. At the end of 3 years, I think the city of Franklin could go back and look, you know, at the windfall or whatever, I think you mentioned windfall, and reevaluate. But I think that even though it's Williamson County Schools, even though I know and I'm told daily, you know, what do you think about schools? And it's not part of the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. We still need to have those partnerships between City of Franklin, County Schools, Franklin Special Schools. So that's how I would allocate the money to still look towards those schools and give a portion of that back to the schools.
Mr. Phillips.
I absolutely support the sales 0.5% sales tax increase. Fully support the city's willingness to give up our half of that half to the school system for 3 years. What does the city do with $10 million? I wouldn't consider it a windfall. What do you do? We're, the city's $188 million in debt, pays $5 million a year in interest on loans. Put it there. Put it in sidewalks, put it in streets, put it in the budget and use it where we can. But we need it, but the schools need it more. And that's a whole nother can of worms and long conversation I'd love to have, but we don't have time this morning.
Mrs. Berger.
First of all, I fully support our schools, absolutely. Sometimes we have to ask ourselves the hard questions, though. Are we doing some of the things we need to be doing? I would certainly support the sales tax referendum if I voted on the board to send that to the voters, and that if they said yes to it, that our city would support it fully, and I do fully support it. No qualms about that whatsoever. But sometimes we also need to look at, some of my constituents have been asking me, what are we doing in the school system and our governments to really seriously audit ourselves and cut waste? When Mr. Stuckey came to the city, we were almost ready to go into a downturn, and he said we have to cut $1 million immediately. Well, I'm not sure of the exact figures, but they came back with more than $1 million in cuts. So once we learned from that, we said, hey, we can do this without losing one employee and without cutting our services. Let's make a policy to do this every year, to cut our waste and to be in a streamlined government. And we're doing a really great job of that. So I would put that back to the schools and ask them to also do the same, because we're not always wanting to throw money at problems, but yet we do need to fund our schools, and I fully support that.
Second Ward, Mr. Vaughn.
You know, I think it's going to be a state issue as the gubernatorial campaign comes along. You're going to start hearing more and more conversation about the BEP, and that's important to Williamson County. BEP payments to Tennessee students is about $4,500 per student, and the state only pays Williamson County schools $3,250 a student. And if you multiply that times 39,000 students a year, you're talking about $48.6 million that the Williamson County schools are missing. So I think to talk about a sales tax referendum right now is a little bit premature, because it could be possible that the education funding formula for the state is going to change and go through some serious considerations. So I say, let's go collect the money that we're owed, and then we'll keep talking about it.
Mr. McClendon.
Both of my sons are the product of Williamson County Public Schools. They went to Hunter's Bend, they went to Grassland Middle, they graduated from Franklin Higher, and they are now at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. I support the local public schools. As an alderman, I voted to send this matter to the people of this county for a referendum. So the answer to the question that was asked is yes. Also, as far as what happens in 3 years, for right now, my commitment would be to sunset the sales tax increase and let it lapse and not continue to collect it. There's a tendency, there's what I call a suitcase law. You will, if you go on a trip, you will fill the suitcase you pick. So, you know, if you pick a smaller suitcase, you'll make do with less. So I don't think that we ought to be in the business of figuring out how to spend tax revenue. We support the schools, we give them the money for 3 years, and when it's over, it's over. Tax goes away, and we carry on.
Ward 3, Mr. Skinner.
Mayor Rogers Anderson, when he presented the resolution for the city to forego its portion of a sales tax increase for 3 years, specifically told us that it was for retirement of debt service that would occur over 3 years. I voted, as the other aldermen voted unanimously, to accept this and to forego our portion of that for a portion of 3 years. One of the reasons that companies locate here, the reason that we have jobs that are available here, is because of the quality of education that we have here. So I think we should also share what we have to make sure that that continues, and that Williamson County School Board is the premier school board here in the state of Tennessee.
Mr. Speedy.
Yes, I'd be in favor of putting the sales tax referendum in front of the voters. I am more in favor of a broader base tax as opposed to having to raise our property taxes. I also will know I'm going to benefit because I've got three kids in the local school systems, but I think we still need to educate the voters, make sure they understand why this will be a good thing for our community. Again, we're recruiting a lot of businesses that come here because of the quality of our schools. At the same time, we need the revenue. There's been other communities around the nation that have proposed either building more schools or going to a year-round or balanced calendar for some elementary schools. They were able to achieve a 25% increase in the student population by going to that type of calendar, and then in 5 or 6 years, that population rectified itself. And so they would have been in a position of having to close schools. So it's not always just a revenue issue. I do think we should look at some of the expenses and maybe alternative solutions.
Fourth Ward, Margaret Martin.
Everything good about our community rests on the endeavors and the citizens and businesses that work together to make Franklin what it is today. The excellent school systems are at the root of this desirable community. If this means supporting a 3-year commitment to aid in the funding of new schools, it is in the best interest of every resident to participate, whether you have children in school or not. However, the small tax increase must be approved by a citizen referendum, and I would certainly encourage everybody to participate positively.
Elizabeth Wanzek.
I support that the city voted to send this to referendum, and I think that's the way to go, to have go to the people. Our schools are our crown jewel. One of the reasons that we were so fortunate to take advantage of the first-time homebuyer's tax credit in 2008, and my husband and I moved to Franklin, is because we had dreams of having a child in the Williamson County school system, which is where our neighborhood is zoned to. My daughter will be 2 the end of the month, and hopefully we'll be entering Perry Creek Elementary in a few years. This is a really big concern, and it's the number one concern I hear as I'm knocking on doors. And I think, you know, while BOMA can't do anything directly for the schools, I think we need to see where we can work with the county and use our leverage to help that in any creative ideas we have, whether that's hoping that we can work with developments to donate land to build new schools, look at different time schedules, and realize that, I mean, every time that we build a new community, 2.5 students are entering the school system, and we don't want to lose that, because one of the major reasons why people want to move here, both individuals, families, and businesses, is because of the schools.
Question 5 of 7 from the Williamson County Association of Realtors.
In your opinion, what part does residential and business development play in the overall economic health of our community?
Second Ward, Dana McClendon.
Well, when I was interviewing as a law student in a big law firm in Nashville, where I ultimately went to work for the first 5 years of my career, I was in a office about 25 floors up, and the partner that was interviewing me said, "Dana, look out the window." And I said, "Yeah, well, yep, okay." And he said, "What do you see?" I said, "I see cranes." He said, "Never live anywhere that you don't see cranes on the skyline, because they're dying." And so I think in this community, it's important that we continue to have the type of growth that we want. We are very blessed in that the decisions that we've been making for a long time have led us to the position where we can pick and choose what it is we're doing. We're recruiting the top level industry here, and the people that go with it are, you know, great folks. So it's an imperative part of our economy to have good jobs and good housing, and we have, I think it can't be stressed enough that it's a good idea for us to plan and have the kind of growth that we want.
Mr. Vaughn.
Well, I think we need to protect the urban growth boundary. You know, we've got a defined boundary that was worked out with state government and others, and I think right now we have a tendency to try to push out beyond that. Large residential developments are on the edge of the city of Franklin, and I think we have a tendency to try to run infrastructure out there so we can eventually annex them. I just don't think we need to be doing that. I think we need to focus on our core. I asked earlier, what do we want to become? I think we need to maintain the small town nature. That is the reason why we all came here. But we can also promote ourselves as a high-tech small town and come up with that balance where we have businesses that we want to be here, but we focus on the neighborhoods and the small towns and the small town environment that we all love and enjoy.
Ward 3, Mr. Speedy.
I do think we want to continue to create a business environment where our existing businesses can thrive. We want to continue to get businesses that want to relocate here. I think the more that we have that type of growth, we further diversify and expand our tax base. I think forget that we're in about a 9-year economic boom that can turn or will turn at some point in time. And I'm a strong believer that the stronger that our business community is, the more opportunities that our businesses can help out our community through some public-private partnerships, whether it's schools, providing internships, apprenticeships, whether it's our transit, getting corporations like Nissan to help fund some of that transit that Bev is talking about in Cool Springs, and just even our nonprofits. The more successful that we've got our businesses, and we want people to put their capital on the line and come to our community and continue to grow.
Mr. Skinner.
Franklin has been very successful in the past with recruiting corporate headquarters. That's critical because with it brings it a certain level of salary and expertise to our county. We have done that because of a number of things. They come here, they recognize the planning that happens in the city of Franklin. We're not helter-skelter about what gets approved and what doesn't. And part of the infrastructure, sometimes we have to make adjustments. There have been areas where we actually decided to have taller buildings in the business here at Cool Springs, and yet staff gave us a fix for this on how we could put more lanes and more infrastructure as those things were adjusted. Again, if we cease to grow, I think we're going to cease to be a viable community, one that provides jobs.
Fourth Ward, Ms. Wanzek.
I think that business and residential development are basically two sides of the same coin. We are having the residential growth that we're having because of the economic success and business growth, and we're having the business growth because of the residential success. I firmly believe that the business community is the backbone to any city, and we want to continue to attract businesses that want to be in this community. That said, we have always had a very delicate tightrope that we have walked to balance our rural landscape, our infrastructure, our industry, and our small town charm. And it may be time to just, you know, sit back down at the table and make sure that we're still keeping all of those things in perfect balance so that we are continuing to be the Franklin that we want to be in the midst of being very blessed to have had such wonderful economic growth and success.
Mrs. Martin.
Business and residential development is crucial to the economics of our community. Citizens are looking for places that will meet their needs for homes, for work, and businesses to help fulfill their needs. If you stop on the street and ask people why they move here, some will say the job. Some will say my family moved here. Some will say, I have no connection with Franklin, I just love it. This is just where I want to be. So they're all reasons, but they're all connected. And they wouldn't stay if they didn't have some of each. Where they live, what they can buy, where they can work. So I think all of these work together to make us the special place that we are. And we're very grateful for that.
Ward 1, Mr. Phillips.
We need to continue to grow. I agree, if we stop growing, we can't survive. We can grow a little more with more, we can grow more careful. And we can enforce our zoning ordinance and require that our infrastructure be in place before we develop. It's great that businesses and developers continue to see Franklin as a highly desirable place to come. I don't expect that to change, and I hope they continue to come. But as we grow and develop, it's important that we keep Franklin, so the people that do use those desirable characteristics, the reasons they moved here or stayed here or returned here, we maintain those as we grow, and we can do that. And Cool Springs is a part of Franklin. It's part of Franklin a lot of people choose to avoid because of traffic. Cool Springs is part of Franklin.
Mrs. Berger.
All right, thank you. Business development reflects the overall health of our community, absolutely. If we don't have jobs and growth, then of course we are dying. In 2005, when I was elected, I was confronted with a vote to either vote for a moratorium on growth or not, and I voted no. That is a very bad idea because I said on that board at the time, I said, we experience a downturn, we will not recover for 15, 20 years. And guess what? We went right into a downturn a couple of years later. So as a small business owner, I understand this. I've been a small business owner since 1996, and I received a chamber award for the small and upcoming business in Huntsville, Alabama in 1997. So I really get this as a small business owner. But local businesses and companies, we have got to help promote them. I know the chamber is doing a great job with help promoting the small businesses that are already here. That's very important that we do not forget our small businesses that are already here, but also help open up the door for new businesses coming. Diversification, absolutely. Opportunities for the next generation, very important.
Mr. Campbell.
Nothing stays the same and change is inevitable. I believe there needs to be a balance between the residential and the business development. Rogers Anderson says, get in your car and drive. And drive till you run out of traffic. And then go over to the town square and tell me what it looks like. When there is not growth and development, you're going to find that it does die. I think there needs to be a healthy balance between both the business and both the residential. We have a great document in place called Envision Franklin. And I think it's important that the Board of Mayor and Aldermen continue to obey that document, go by the guidelines, and also to build some public-private partnerships.
The sixth and final question from Williamson, Inc.
Thanks, Tom. We know that 60% of the residents in Williamson County are not even from the state of Tennessee. In light of those migration numbers, and we've had a lot of conversation this morning about maintaining the charm and character of Franklin, what's one thing or the first thing you do to maintain that charm and character? And also, specifically, would you be in favor of capping the population of the city of Franklin? Thanks.
Third Ward, Michael Skinner.
Capping the population? No, I think we all have the right to continue to have children. Franklin is one of those cities that has, we've done a good job. We've done a good job with preservation and with being progressive with growth. It's almost like there's the old Franklin and then there's the Cool Springs Franklin. Everybody can get a Cool Springs Franklin. Everybody can have a Galleria. We're lucky to have it, and I don't discount that. But we also, there were people years ago that made the effort to preserve our downtown. And it always makes me proud to go downtown and see the throngs of people that are down there shopping because it is something different, it is unique, and I think it serves us well.
Mr. Speedy.
I'm pretty sure I can see on Mike's notes, he says something about building the southern wall on Franklin. So. No, I don't think you can cap the population. I am a big favor of our southern charm. People have asked me, am I for preservation? I tell them my short answer is my oldest son's name is Carter. So I'm for that. I do think there's one thing that we could even continue to enhance the southern charm that we have. I think the Harpeth River is still a very underutilized resource. I'm guilty of this too. Until about 4 years ago, I had never been on the Harpeth River, and until you take your kids out or whoever you take out and kayak on the Harpeth River, you don't really understand the geographical significance of the Harpeth. Walking across the river back from Pilgrimage Festival on Saturday night, you walk across that bridge, and unless you know it's there, you don't know it's there. So I still think that could be a beautiful gateway to the city of Franklin. So yes, I'm for the charm.
Fourth Ward, Margaret Martin.
Well, I think that what makes Franklin special is a little bit elusive. I don't know that you can put your finger on it. But as you asked me before, Tom, what I thought about it, I think it's the people. When visitors come to Franklin and they come by our house and stop in and have lemonade on the porch, they're going to remember that more than they remember something else, I hope, the trash on the street or whatever. But I think it's the people, and I think the warm friendliness, and it is what people remember about Franklin. I think it's that elusive spirit that we have in Franklin that my mother always said to newcomers, if you just open your arms, Franklin will fall in. And I really think that's pretty good. That's pretty true. So I would say it's the people.
Elizabeth Wanzek.
I'll answer the second part of the question first. No, I think that is an absolutely ridiculous idea to cap the population of the city. I don't think that's the city government's place. I mean, that gets into a whole host of things that I'm very grateful as we campaign that we don't have to talk about when I knock on doors. But as far as maintaining something special in Franklin, you know, and I am running for Ward 4 Alderman, but it is just maintaining our downtown and making sure that we're doing everything to preserve and protect what makes everyone just absolutely fall in love with us when they walk down our streets. It's making sure that our small businesses feel incentivized to not be moving out of the inner core. It's making sure that we maintain our parks and our streets and that we, you know, really focus on the people that live down there and what they're interested in seeing for their immediate community that so many people take advantage of. And I'm very grateful to live in Franklin.
First Ward, Mrs. Berger.
Well, one of the things that you can do to maintain the quality is to reelect Alderman Bev Berger. I will serve the people with all the same energy that I have in the past and with the integrity of serving our citizens. But if we take a look at this seriously, when I ran for office in 2005, Miss Mayor Loretta sat down with me and we talked about Franklin. Even though I'd visited here many years in the 80s and 90s, I really wanted to get to the heart of Franklin, and she was so kind to spend hours with me, and she said, you know what? Here's my opinion, and here are the facts, and here's my opinion. Now, you'll want to go talk to other people and get their opinions. And I really thought that was wonderful. And so when I look at this and I say, what can we do to maintain the quality? Stick to our good plans. Stick to being committed to Franklin. Franklin's two sisters, downtown, Cool Springs. They're not identical twins. They're two sisters. They're very unique, but they're in the same family, and we need to remember that. They don't dress alike, they don't look alike, but they are in the same family. We have to protect that.
Mr. Campbell.
I would definitely agree it's the people who make Franklin the great place it is to live, work, play, visit, and call home. When I'm out and about and I'm talking to people, I mean, there's so many great things about Franklin. One of the things that I love are the parks, all the places to walk. I walk daily. I walk a lot more now that I'm knocking on doors, but I love the parks. I do think we need to look at Riverwalk. We need to look at, you know, a lot of other things that we can do to enhance. Capping the population? Absolutely not. When I talk to people and they say, what happened? How did we explode? I look at them and kind of smile and say, because we all didn't keep it a secret. We love it here and we want to be here. So keep Franklin, Franklin. It's going to change, but we can embrace the change and we can move forward into the future with hope.
Mr. Phillips.
Matt, I appreciate the softballs. 60% of our population is not from Tennessee. Diversity makes us stronger. Cap the population. I do not support building a wall. What would I do to help preserve Franklin's character? I would start a grassroots effort and engage the community to keep Franklin, Franklin, and continue that engagement. Oh, wait, I've been doing that for the past 2 years. You know, we want to maintain that small town charm, the quality of life, the great schools, affordability, low crime, scenic view sheds. And we can do that. We can grow and keep the character at the same time. And we're doing that. And we'll continue to do that. I'll continue to do that with your help and support. Thanks.
Second Ward, Mr. Vaughn.
To the question about limit population, I don't think you can limit individual population, but I do think that you can control density. And I'm focused on Ward 2. Ward 2 is primarily and almost 100% comprised of neighborhoods where people live. And most of these neighborhoods have been here quite a while. And one thing I'm hearing all throughout all those neighborhoods is that the development has gotten out of control, that everybody's afraid that they're going to pack in a dense residential development right next to an existing development. So I am for some form of limited development control inside Ward 2 where the neighborhoods exist now, because we are focused on small towns. That's why people move here. That's why people want to be here. And secondly, I'm for the Harpeth River. I think it's an underdeveloped asset in our county and in our city. And I think we need to do everything to protect the quality of the water and the air and all the features that it brings to us in our environment that we so enjoy and love.
Mr. McClendon.
I was really privileged the other night to be asked to present a proclamation on behalf of the City of Franklin to Boy Scout Troop 135. That troop has been in Franklin for 75 years. They've produced 135 Eagle Scouts. That's an amazing number of young men who've been benefited by the enrichment of this community. So the thing that I would focus on and will continue to focus on is the people of this community. That's what makes it different. No one part of our city is more important or less important than another. They're different and they're great, but they're not better or more important. It's the people. And that's why people continue to come here. So I think what we need to focus on is engaging people that arrive here and enhancing the things that made them pick this and addressing the issues that more people bring. So it's engaging the people that choose to make Franklin their home. So that's what I would focus on.
It's time for closing statements. First Ward, Michael Phillips.
I'm not a politician. I have no desire to be a politician. I'm just a guy that likes to help. I'm retired, have the time and a desire to continue doing that. In Ward 1 especially, but throughout the city, the growth over the next 4 years will be far too important to leave in the hands of the people who controlled it for the last 4 years or 12 years. I have been reaching out into the community, informing you of what the issues are, asking for your input and your opinions on those issues. And I have been your voice inside City Hall for the last couple of years. And I will continue to be your voice inside City Hall. Thanks.
Beverly Berger.
I'm always accessible to my constituents. We communicate by phone, in person, HOA meetings, always before casting my vote for a special issue, I always contact them. My background and my skill sets have taught me to be a problem solver. My constituents and I have worked together to solve some of these problems. For example, sewers for neighborhoods with failing septic systems, neighborhood stormwater restoration projects, one completed, one in process, six major projects with McEwen, four with Crothers, McEwen phase four, moving to right away and acquisition, 20 sidewalks repaired or added in the last year. During my tenure, I've acted on your behalf, and I have been the strongest advocate for the people in Ward 1. So let's continue to be proactive together, Ward 1, not reactive. It's important. If you want a public servant with experience, the right skill sets, insight, dedication, and the energy, then I ask for your vote. Thank you.
J. Edward Campbell.
As I've knocked on doors and walked around Ward 1, I keep hearing continually from people, I want an alderman who will represent residential as well as commercial and development. I am a realtor. I do not own my own real estate company. I work for a company. I am not in touch with any of the developers. I don't represent any real estate developers or commercial or retail developers. So I represent myself. I do not have an agenda other than to serve Ward 1 and to serve the city of Franklin. People ask me to be accessible. I've done that with my email, with my phone. I am accessible. And, as I look to the future, I look to the opportunity to serve the Franklin that I grew to love in 1976 and continue to today.
Second Ward, Dana McClendon.
Well, since 1997, it's been my privilege and honor to represent Ward 2. I've done a lot of work, not only for the city, but for the ward in particular. You know, Hillsborough Road didn't happen by accident. That project's winding down. Sidewalks to connect the far west of the ward to downtown, up Franklin Road, just any number of projects that I've been able to work with my fellow aldermen on to get done for the ward. That's the thing I'm going to continue to do, is to advocate for the ward and also advocate for the city as a whole. As I said, it's been a real privilege and an honor to represent people. This is my life of service. You know, Mr. Vaughn keeps telling people that I'm a career politician. I call it leading a life of service. I'm an Eagle Scout, and it wasn't a hard transition to go from being an 18-year-old Eagle Scout to being a city alderman. That's what I know how to do. So with your vote and your support, I'll continue to represent you, and we'll make this place a great place to live and work.
Mr. Vaughn.
Thank you. I believe that as a Ward 2 alderman, I must be responsive, receptive, and encourage an open dialogue. The BOMA must be proactive and engage issues early on rather than being reactive. We need to be proactive. The alderman is the trustee of the community that elects him or her, and that trustee must be accessible and willing to collaborate with all members of the community, and that includes neighborhoods, advocacy groups, and of course, individual residents. Anyone that lives in Ward 2 in Franklin has the right to be heard and not just to speak. A board member must build public understanding and support participation, but there comes a time in any business or any government when you need new ideas, you need better solutions. Applaud anybody who wants to serve and volunteers themselves for being in public service, but after 20 years, we need new blood. We need to move on with new ideas and better solutions, and that's what I bring with from a private business perspective. And as a person who used to help homeowners in our neighborhood association deal with the city, which at times is overwhelming and difficult. Thank you, and I'd like to have your vote.
Ward 3, Michael Skinner.
I think for the third ward, we have a clear choice. We have somebody that's demonstrated leadership ability, that has a history of being dependable, honest, and has shown that he works with neighborhoods for their defense and that they aren't built out with high density development. If you like what Franklin is now, then I think you should continue to vote for leadership that helped it become what it is now. So, again, I'd hope you'd reelect Mike Skinner, Third Ward Alderman.
Scott Speedy.
Franklin's had tremendous growth, and with that growth comes challenges, and I'm willing to tackle those head on. I too feel like there's a very clear choice in Ward 3. I feel like I've got a different set of life experiences, a professional background, and experience as a small business owner that can really benefit the city of Franklin. I'm engaged every day in my business with individuals and business owners in the business environment. I'm engaged with three different schools every day when the kids come home. I'm a user of the Harlansdale Dog Park. I'm a user of the Harpeth River. So I feel like I've got a really good pulse on this community, and that's why I ask for your support. And again, I'll go back to the three things I said. I'll always support our existing small business owners here in Franklin so they can thrive to where we can still recruit great businesses here for the jobs. I'm always going to be a supporter of the historic preservation efforts. And as a financial planner, I feel like that planning background is invaluable to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. And I'll help keep our city fiscally responsible and strong.
Fourth Ward, Margaret Martin.
The Fourth Ward encompasses both old and new neighborhoods. And it's important to keep a balance of improvements so that we continue to be a city where people want to live and work. My door is always open to residents who wish to discuss issues. It is my hope that all residents feel a love for this wonderful place we call home. And it is my desire to help ensure it by serving as their Fourth Ward Alderman. I would appreciate your vote.
Elizabeth Wanzak.
My name is Elizabeth Downing-Wanzak, and I am running for alderman because Franklin is truly at a pivotal point in its story. Growth brings challenges that require attentive answers and stewardship to incorporate our history harmoniously into our future. And I think it's time for some new ideas and to see what the Franklin, how Franklin's going to go from here. The issues I stand for are planned sustainable growth, improving our infrastructure, maintaining high quality life, and have good public safety. I'm honest, hardworking, dedicated, empathetic, and responsive. And I want to be hearing from our community and making sure that we are involving everyone to have the community that we want. I would appreciate your vote.
Mindy Tate, it's 11:05 and we're done.
We are done. Thank you so much to Tom Lawrence from WAKM for being our moderator. But also thank you to each of these candidates who has put themselves forward as for your consideration for voting. Remember, the election is October 24th, but early voting continues through October 19th, even on Saturdays from 8 a.m. until noon at the county complex at 1320 West Main Street. We appreciate the support and participation of the Williamson County Association of Realtors, Williamson, Inc., and the Williamson Herald. This is our Frank Talks. It's always on the second Monday of the month, and we hope that you'll stay engaged and involved in our community. Thank you again to all the candidates, and thank you for being here, and we look forward to seeing you next month.